from Mumbai, sharing his vast experience in treating calcaneal fractures. He'll be talking on depressed intra-articular calcaneal fractures, tips and tricks. He'll be talking about the selection of cases which can be treated by this minimally invasive surgery. We also have panelists in the form of Dr. Vaibhav Gandhi from ACLUS, Dr. Sampar Dumre Patil from Pune, and Dr. Mahendra Kurchatkar from Goa. To introduce our today's speaker, Professor Dr. Ashok Kumar Rathod, is a professor and spine unit chief at Sion Hospital and Lokmanya Tilak Medical College, that is LTMG Hospital in Mumbai, for the last 10 years. He's a product of KM Medical College and GS Medical College and Hospital, and trained under Professor Dr. Vijay Lahiri. He was lucky to carry forward the legacy of legendary Dr. Lahiri in the field of spine deformity like scoliosis, kyphosis, and craniovertebral junction surgeries. He's a very renowned complex spinal surgeon working in Bombay. But today we have asked him to talk about calcaneal fractures because one of his students sent a message to Dr. Ashok Sham that we should listen to Dr. Ashok Kumar Rathod about calcaneal fracture fixation. So his tips and tricks are very, very useful. So that was none other than Dr. Piyush Gadegone who sent that message to Dr. Ashok Sham. Ashok in turn forwarded the message to me, and that's how we got hold of Dr. Ashok Kumar Rathod for today's lecture on calcaneal fractures. He has tremendous interest in advanced trauma like pelvic acetabular and calcaneal fractures. He's on the panel on advanced pelvic acetabular courses also. He has presented papers on technique of open reduction and minimal internal fixation of depressed calcaneal fractures in Virop 2003, and he has guided many residents and also other persons in the department like the lecturers and assistant professors alike in proper selection of cases for treating such calcaneal fractures. Though he is primarily a spine surgeon with many international publications in reputed spine journals, he has keen interest in teaching his experience in managing complex trauma also. Today only I saw one of his papers being published. I don't have the details in front of me, but congratulations, Dr. Rathod, for that.
Yeah, thank you very much. That was in spine deformity.
Yeah, okay, thank you. And to introduce our panelists today, Dr. Vaibhav Gandhi, who did his MBBS and MS from Solapur, is alumnus of Dr. VM Medical College, Solapur. He has worked as registrar in the Department of Orthopedics at Baba Bandra Municipal Hospital in Mumbai. And at present, he is having his own 30-bed Vitrag Hospital, a very advanced state-of-the-art orthopedic hospital with polytrauma management, joint replacement, arthroscopy, and spine surgery center. Friends, ACLUS is a very small, it's a village. It is not even a taluka place, but he has done tremendous work. And he has conducted even the pelvic acetabular workshop live demonstration when the President-elect Dr. Ramesh Sen had come about 5 years back to demonstrate the surgery at his hospital. That is his keen interest in organizing CMEs and workshop for the benefit of all the people. He's having the state-of-the-art own conference hall with modern audiovisual system used for academic activities and patient counseling and educational activities. He has presented many papers in regional, state, national, and international conferences and workshops. Actively participated in organizing academic live operative workshops and conferences. He has organized pre-plastic surgery camps at ACLUS between 2003 to 2008 at his hospital. And he has also organized many blood donation camps in and around ACLUS. And he has also conducted many free diagnostic camps and BND camps. He was the organizing secretary for Maharashtra Orthopedic Association Regional Conference, MORCON, which was held in ACLUS in 2011. Hence, my association with Vaibhav Gandhi is from the first day of my orthopedics. So the first day when I joined the department, I was asked to do a patellectomy for a badly comminuted fracture of the patella. Dr. Vaibhav Gandhi assisted me. So he's my first orthopedic guru. Welcome, Dr. Vaibhav Gandhi.
Thank you very much, Shiva.
We have Dr. Sampath Dumre Patil, is a past president of the Foot and Ankle Society of India. He is at present director, Department of Orthopedics at Sahyadri Super Speciality Hospital in Adapsar, Pune. He is the ex-president of Indian Foot and Ankle Society, ex-executive council member on AO Trauma India, ex-executive committee member on both Indian Orthopedic Association as well as Maharashtra Orthopedic Association. He is the associate editor for BMC Musculoskeletal Journal. Welcome, Dr. Sampath.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Mahendra Kurchetkar is from Goa and is alumnus of Goa Medical College, and he won the best medical graduate of the year 1989 when he passed his MBBS. He is the head of the Department of Orthopedic Surgery at Healthway Group of Hospitals in Goa. He is a national faculty for foot and ankle surgery, national ATLS instructor, national AO table instructor. He has specialist interest in adult reconstruction, foot and ankle surgery, primary and revision joint replacement surgeries. At present, he is the president of the Indian Foot and Ankle Society. He is also a Rotarian. Even Dr. Vaibhav Gandhi is also a Rotarian. And I welcome all of them for today's lecture. Friends, what is blinking, what you can see is my WhatsApp number. If you have any question to Professor Dr. Ashok Kumar Rathod, so you can WhatsApp me your questions. I will take at the end of the talk. I welcome Dr. Ashok Kumar Rathod for today's talk on depressed intra-articular calcaneal fractures, tips and tricks. I must also mention the support from the Ortho TV technical team headed by Dr. Ashok Shyam and Neeraj Bijlani for this one person, one talk series. Thank you very much. Over to you, Professor Rathod.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shivshankar, for such a kind introduction. And thank you very much, all the panelists, Dr. Mahendra, Dr. Sorry, I just forgot the names. But I welcome all of you for the panel. Yeah, thank you very much. I'll share the screen.
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah.
Yeah, Ashok. Yeah, thank you very much. I think it's...
Yes.
Yes. Ashok, how to minimize the...
You shared it well, sir. You can just...
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Yeah, thank you very much and good evening, all my friends. Today I'm going to talk amongst all the stalwarts of Foot and Ankle Society on tips and tricks of the open reduction and the minimal internal fixation in displaced intra-articular fractures. But for the benefit of the whole ankle foot surgeons and all my resident friends and the other budding orthopedic surgeons, let me just go through a bit of history, or in fact, a sustainable amount of the anatomy, which I would like to show, because I think a lot of confusion is being created only because, like, we have a very poor understanding of calcaneum and the ankle foot. So let me start saying that calcaneum is a very funnily shaped bone, if you can say, but it's held in a very beautifully articulated manner so that we get the best landing position and the best landing mechanism for our body. And so that we get a good equilateral weight distributions along the medial and the lateral arches along it. It has got an articulation above with the talus. It's got an articulation in front with the cuboid. Posteriorly, it has got one of the strongest muscle in the body, the gastrocnemius attachment to the tuberosity. Via tendocles, which always tries to keep it pulled up and tries to push it into equinus. And these forces are nicely neutralized and it's being held in a slightly upright position with the help of the plantar fascia, the intrinsics, yes, and the long dorsiflexors there, which are all very helpful in maintaining these arches of the foot, which are, as I said earlier, are very important in equilateral avet distribution of the foot. It also has got a bit structurally different as compared to the other bones, in the sense that it has got a more of a cancellous bone and a few cortical thickenings. So we got to know, like I said, what are these thickened bones along the loading areas so that we can make use of it in, yeah, we can use it for fixation points or anchoring points for our fixation during our future course of open reduction and internal fixation there. So usually this bone is basically like a spongy bone, a lot of a cancellous bone, and along the loading areas, like this thalamic areas, the thalamic area is called, it's a basically the bone under the posterior facet, under the tailor there. Angle of Giessen, which bears the brunt of the anterior and the lateral process of the talus, a mild thickening along the calcaneocuboid joint, and yes, a very good bone at the attachment of the tendo Achilles. And the bone also, where we land our foot, that's a calcaneal heel, you know, where there is attachment of the plantar fascia and the intrinsics there. This area also has got a lot of thickening, but obviously we should avoid any anchoring of any implants in this area because these are the landing points and we don't want any foot pain or a chronic foot pain later. So we should avoid this area. A few points about the heel pad in that sense, because many of the calcaneal fractures, they still have some chronic foot pain. And normally in the heel pad is consisting of a lot of fat globules which are trapped in this septi, beautifully trapped septi. And this septi maintains a beautiful cushion. So when injured there, the septi are broken. And when these septi are broken, they are source of a chronic heel pain, it can be there. So we unnecessarily do not want to give any iatrogenic heel pain to this patient. So in such situations, we should never take any incision there, like for putting nail or screws or anything. In case if it requires, we should take an incision at a watershed area and then dissect it. Okay. If you look at from a lateral aspect, that's the anterior facet and that's the middle facet. And in between these two is the sustentaculum tali, which is hidden by the talus. So we can't see the sustentaculum from the lateral side, but that sustentaculum harbors the middle facet. Both anterior and middle facet supports the head of the talus. And this sustentaculum tali is another important source of a thickened bone in the calcaneum, and it should be utilized for passing the screws or anchoring points. And the plane of this sustentaculum tali to the posterior facet is slightly about 15 to 20 degrees tiffillate. So this we should take care, you know, while passing the screws, the interflex screws through the facet, so that it is always directed about 15, 20 degrees tiffillate into the sustentaculum tali. Now, if you see this, both the medial surface of the calcaneum is sloped. It's markedly sloped because of the sustentaculum tali, whereas the lateral surface is relatively flat. There, so we can make use of this relatively flat lateral surface so that we can fit almost any kind of plate, a reconstruction plate, or even the commonly known Saunders plate there, or we can use a subarticular screw in the thalamic region, screws in the Giessen's angle, or we can pass taking this flat lateral surface as a reference. We can pass a sand screw or a stamen pin or a thick K wire parallel to this lateral surface, about a centimeter or 1.5 centimeter medial to the lateral surface, but parallel to it, and we can use it like an SX laparoscopy, like a joystick in a joystick manual. there, or we can put even a screw that way. Okay. So when we see this kind of calcaneal fracture, a patient comes to it, which I think Emil Letourneau has very famously described. It's an unintelligible collection of bone there, and it's like a puzzle box. We don't know what to do, what solution, and like we don't know whether we can reconstruct it or so. And the thing, first of all, then it comes to our mind, is it so important to us? And like many of us think in the patient, oh, this bone doesn't need any importance, and we just try to neglect it, we just try to ignore it. But then obviously we cannot ignore the patient, because the something needs to be done to the patient there. So we give POP and we call it as a conservative treatment. Actually, any treatment, any conservative treatment should yield the same ideal goals of like your surgical treatment. So the whole summary of this whole history is that it is probably one of the most neglected part of the body, calcaneum. But why is it controversial, or is it controversial at all? I don't think so. Way back in 1960s, Letourneau said that all calcaneal fractures should be treated like any other intra-articular fractures with rigid fixation and early mobilization there. Both the hind foot, talus and calcaneum, are basically the two biggest pillars of the hind foot. And like I said earlier, they are very important for equilateral weight distribution along the arches, because whenever we have a flattened calcaneum, it is basically like a functional flat foot. And like whenever we have a flat foot, there is obviously our intrinsics of the foot are at a disadvantage, and that can be the cause of a chronic fatigue foot pain there. Its main function of the calcaneus is basically, when we said it is the landing bone, yeah. Above, it acts as a platform to support the talus. Because of its peculiar shape, it has the bolus angle and a particular posterior facet inclination, which is very important for maintaining this talar inclination angle there. And this talar inclination angle is equally important for full ankle range of motion. And it acts as a tripod for an equilateral weight distribution. So what is this bolus angle? It's also called as a tuber joint angle or the tuberosity end joint angle. It is basically an angle between the non-articular portion, that's the tuberosities, and the articular portion of the calcaneum, which is approximately around 40 degrees. That goes to around 135 degree, approximately around on the broader side. 135 is a very popular term in orthopedics. So like that. And because of this bolus angle, the calcaneum maintains its height. And this calcaneal height is also the height of the foot there. And the height of the foot, the height of the calcaneum, is responsible for a good width of the calcaneum. Another important thing is the angle of Giessen. This Giessen angle is basically the angle formed by the posterior facet of the calcaneum with the anterior calcaneum. It's approximately around 90 degrees, and that's why it is called as the acute angle of Giessen. It basically bears the brunt of the anterior part of the inferior facet of the talus with the lateral process. So it's quite thick an area there. And maintaining this or restoring this Giessen angle, it automatically restores the overall length of the calcaneum there. Okay. And so both this bolus angle and the Giessen angle are equally important for maintaining the length, the height of the calcaneum, and thereby maintaining the talar inclination angle there. Now, if you look it from top, the tail is, that's the long axis of its neck. But if you look at the superior dome of the talus, which articulates with the tibial plafond, the long axis of that superior dome is about 15-20 degrees in valgus to the long axis of the neck. And if you notice the posterior, the inferior facet of the talus, which articulates with calcaneum, that's about another 30 degrees with respect to the superior facet or the superior dome there. So approximately, if you see this, there is about 45 degrees angle between the neck of the talus, which articulates with the head of the talus axis, which articulates with the navicular and the medial arch and the calcaneum, the facet, the posterior facet, about 45 degrees there. Okay. Now that's a beautiful view from the sinus tarsi, which shows us both the posterior facet as well as the sustentaculum tali there. And if you see here, that's the medial border of the talus, the posterior facet, which makes contact with the medial border of the inferior facet of the talus. And this is because the impaction force is usually first in contact with this medial border of this posterior facet. And like here, if you draw a line, it usually divides this calcaneum into the posterior facet and the tuberosity part and the anterior calcaneum with the sustentaculum part. Okay, so as you can see on the left hand side, that's how the medial border of the posterior facet, and the impact is usually almost always is along this medial facetal contact line. So whenever there is impact and whenever there is a fracture, usually this fracture starts at the lateral process there. It goes behind along this medial border, either a little more medially or a little more laterally into the joint, and then going down on the plantar aspect. So this fracture line will divide this calcaneum into the posterior lateral tuberosity fragment and the anteromedial sustentacular fragment. Okay. Now, if the force still continues, either the force will stop it because of the pain and the patient just lifts up the leg, or if the force still continues, then this posterior lateral tuberosity fragment, it sinks anteriorly with a tuberosity effectively getting elevated and the posterior facet getting sinked into the anterior calcaneum. This is how it happens there. And this effectively makes the whole Bohler angle almost to 0 degrees there. Okay. And this, because the Bohler is zero, the effective height of the calcaneum is also shortened there. So as you know, this, because of the overriding of the fragment, the posterolateral portion of the calcaneal fracture, because it overrides up, it impinges on the calcaneum, or it impinges on the peroneal tendon, which lies between the lower part of the lateral malleolus and the lateral part of the calcaneum. So this is the reason for getting a peroneal impingement if the calcaneum is widened or its width is increased there. So it's equally important. So the height of the calcaneum is inversely proportional to the width of the calcaneum, right? Yeah. So we need to restore the height, or we need to increase the height of the calcaneum so as to get its width reduced there. Okay. And this decreased width, as I said, it prevents the peroneal impingement, also helps in restoring the bohler's tuber joint angle and the talar inclination angle. These are all very important for maintenance of the medial and lateral longitudinal arch and in preventing a functional flat foot and the consequence of chronic fatigue pain. Now, restoring this normal calcaneal anatomy is very important for maintaining the relation between talus, calcaneum, navicular, cuboid, because all of them, they have a complex but a synchronous and harmonious hind foot and the midfoot movements. And so a displaced or fracture, if untreated, it will go into a malunion. Later, if it is a displaced intra-articular fracture, it will go into a subtalar arthritis if possible. There will be shortened height because of the wide calcaneum. There can be impingement, or there can be a shoe wear problems. And because of the altered foot biomechanics of the arches, obviously there will be a chronic discomfort and a fatigue pain. So my friends, all of you will realize then, oh, this bone is so very, very important. Then why not we treat it properly? So what's the controversy then? Subtalar arthritis? Except like any other intra-articular depressed fracture, whether it's in the spine or in the tibial condyle or anywhere, or acetabulum, anywhere. Any intra-articular displaced fracture and arthritis can be a potential sequelae even after surgical reduction, because any impaction fractures across the joint, well, there can be a condyl damage or there can be a cartilage damage. So obviously one can never assure in any impacted, any depressed articular fractures, okay, he will never have an arthritis. So it is always a potential sequelae. So then the argument comes like, fine, anyway, this bone unites so well, it's not a problem. And in case if it develops a subtalar arthritis, then we might as well do a late single stage subtalar arthrodesis. Why not that? Why to operate now there? But the results of the subtalar fusion in malunited position are almost universally poor at 5 years of follow-up there. That's because unless we restore the foot biomechanics, the intrinsics are not up to their optimal length or not up to in their optimal function. And hence the footic pain in the foot still persists with discomfort and intermittent pain there. So Romash, like when he published in 1993, CRR, he advises to recreate the original fracture with osteotomy of in this malunited calcaneal fractures. You restore the height of the calcaneum, the width and the length of the calcaneum, restore the bolus angles, the Gissens angle, and then do a subtalar fusion in biomechanically aligned calcaneum. That will give a painless and biomechanically sound foot. So that's the newer trend, and that is how it should be, because foot is obviously very important to our daily life. But then we have certain fears, like it's a subcutaneous bone, so if we try to do any open reduction, we try to do anything, there can be a wound problem. The implants can stare at you if it gets infected, if there is a wound adhesions. So that is a serious fear in almost every orthopedic surgeon's mind. Another fear is definitely the poor understanding of the fracture pattern, the anatomy, and how it actually occurs and how we can reconstruct. And hence, many of us are a little confused. And then there are n number of procedures which have been described for calcaneal fractures, and we don't know which procedure yields best results in our hands. Starting from Essex Loprasty, his own method, which very classically described for basically the tongue-shaped fracture or the two-part fracture, where putting a stamen pin, reduce it, and then put them into cast to a percutaneous KY joystick manual fixation. The fixator application, we have open reduction with plate fixation, open reduction with only screw fixations, open reduction with minimal fixations. So we have so many coming up, and still many more methods are being described recently. I'll throw some light at the end on it. But many things, still think malunion is not a problem. We Indians have plenty of tolerance level. If we can walk with 16, 80 degrees of varusni for years and years, I think a malunited calcaneum should not be a problem. And anyway, the patient will start walking after 2 to 3 months, and we'll see. So we'll just leave it now, and we'll see if arthritis develops. So that's the usually general trend, even in the present generation, as well as in my own generation, as well as the older generation also. There are certain groups of people who always argue in that. But my question is, why allow it to malunite when it is so important for our day-to-day life? But I'll just assure that not all calcaneal fractures require open reduction and internal fixation. So don't be scared. You see calcaneum and all of them requires open reduction. In fact, many of them can be treated with percutaneous techniques with very good results. And a very few requires open reduction and internal fixations. It's very important to understand the fracture geography and classify them. I basically very simply classify into either a two-part fracture or a comminuted fractures. Because simple two-part fractures, in fact, any undisplaced fractures, and if displaced, then whether it's a two-part fracture or a comminuted fracture. Basically, any two-part fracture, it acts like a split fractures, so that it can be a medial fragment is usually aligned to the sustentaculum telli and the rest of the forefoot. The posterolateral fragment, which is basically depressed or tilted in that sense, usually can be handled or manipulated with the help of a thick K-wire, stamen pins, hand screw, whatever you want to, and use it like a joystick to maneuver it. So that's basically would fit into a simple two-part fracture, whether it's intra-articular or extra-articular. Okay. The second category is basically a comminuted fracture, which are still reconstructible with open reduction and internal fixations. There are many classifications being described, starting with Essex laparoscopy, which describes tongue type and joint depression type, classification by Saunders, Levine and Zweig, etc. There are many classifications we describe, and I think it's available in the literature, so I did not unnecessarily go into it there. But I think after we started doing CT scans there, it has suddenly helped us in basically visualizing with a 3D reconstructions and other things how exactly this fracture pattern occurs. And it has really helped in understanding there. And so a CT scan is basically a very important investigation in all displaced intra-articular calcaneal fractures. Basically divides into an undisplaced intra-articular fractures, a new CT scan classification, and an extra-articular fractures. If it is intra-articular, two-part, three-part, type 2BC, okay, and a three-part. So I'll not go into details, but a simple classification is this. Like as I said, the impact is always along the medial facetal contact line. And so if you have a fracture medial to the medial border of the posterior facet, it divides into posterolateral and anteromedial fragments, this fracture is basically called as a prethalamic. Okay, since the posterior facet and the area under it is called as the thalamic area, it's called as a prethalamic extra-articular fractures. If the fracture is lateral to the posterior facet, it's called as a are post-thalamic extra-articular fractures. So whether it is extra or intra-articular there. So if it is only a two-part fracture, which is even intra-articular fractures like this, and there is an overriding of the fragments and the tilting of the fragments like this. But if it is a two-part, it still can be treated with the help of a joystick maneuver. So a two-part fracture, if it is intra-articular or extra-articular, but if tilted or depressed, it requires treatment, and not only for the joint, but also for the foot biomechanics. So in my opinion, usually, I usually don't pay much attention for whether it's intra-articular or extra-articular. Intra-articular is more important if it is usually a three-part fracture and it's more complex. But if it is basically a two-part fracture, or what we call is, and if tilted, what very classically Essex Leprosity has described as a tongue shape, it basically requires a treatment in the form of a joystick maneuver with the help of so many things as I described earlier there. After the CT scans, actually now even the X-rays, we understand a bit better, like what is going to depression, like what is that vertical line and all those things. And if it is a good broadened sieve, it almost will show you a three-part fractures with a central depression fracture, as you can see it here. Okay, so a two-part split fracture, whether extra or intra-articular, as I say. If it is tilted, if it is depressed, yes. And with a bolus angle flat, we can use this thickened area along the attachments of the tendon Achilles to put a sand screw or a stamen pin or a thick K wire. Introduce it along in the force in this angle up to the fracture line, and then use it to depress it. Okay. Reduce it so that the whole tilt of the calcaneum is corrected, and then you advance it further. So that's the simplest thing what you can do, and we can still restore the anatomy of the calcaneum. We can put even screws also if you don't want to put a percutaneous a sand screw or a stamen pin there. But the principle is the same there. Like here, I have used a K-vise there, or you can use even the screws to maintain it there. But the crux comes when the force still continues, like a tibial condyle. And the whole articular fragment is almost into two-part or a three-part fracture. And then the middle part gets depressed suddenly with ballooning out of the lateral wall. This, as you can see, the ballooning out of the lateral wall and then the depressed portion inside. This, in my opinion, are the real indications for open reduction of the calcaneal fractures, because here is a bit difficult to do any percutaneous procedure because it will be really blind in doing anything of these things. Okay, so the goals of the treatment we discussed is, of course, the intra-articular reduction of the posterior facet, very important to prevent arthritis there. If we see, if like any intra-articular fractures, as I said, we cannot guarantee 100% it will not go into arthritis. But if we don't reduce it, it 100% will go into arthritis. If we reduce it, we may reduce the incidence of post-operative arthritis, maybe even less than 10%, maybe even to 0%. So I think, like, why not give it a try? So of course, the first goal is intra-articular reduction of the posterior facet or the intra-articular fracture there. And second, once the reduction is done, yes, we should restore the bolus angle by pulling the tuberosity down and by elevating the facet, the depressed facet, so that we restore the height and thereby we restore the width of the meson. Then we restore the Gissen's angle, that automatically will help in restoring the length of the calcaneum. So height, width, length, articular congruity, and of course all these four components are required for painless and biomechanically sound foot there. And I just said calcaneum, a lateral surface is an absolutely subcutaneous bone, and a lot of fear about wound problems, the wound adhesion. So a good surgical technique is a must, and not a very rock technique of retraction or dissection or something. So a good surgical technique should give less wound problems. How I do it? usually preoperatively, I give them a strict elevation, ice fermentation, at least till the wrinkle sign appears. But of course, like in my hospital, very often sometimes we delay it and we don't get OT time to operate it. And we have repented quite a few. My residents have explored calcaneum and they find the calcaneum is united if operated after 2 weeks. In fact, by 3 weeks, it is almost like a so gummy you will have to recreate the fracture. So my sincere advice is usually don't operate after 2 weeks. Always operate before 10 days, especially within the first week. But at the same time, get the skin back to normal at the earliest possible with all this ice fermentation, elevation, chimeral, phlogam, everything. And let the wrinkle sign appear first. That means the skin has regained its texture. Skin has regained its vascularity. Certain extent, and it will be able to withstand any trauma. Otherwise, in a traumatically contused skin, it might not be able to withstand the trauma, and it might all necrose the whole flap there. I usually do it in lateral position there. Mark out the tip of the lateral malleolus. Mark out the tip of the heel there. Take the midpoint, and I take an L-shaped incision, either a very sharp L, or you can take a slightly smooth L-shaped incision in the watershed area, has been shown here. The middle part here, that's approximately about 2 centimeter below and above, it's a pure bone. And that is the area which usually gives rise to problem in wound adhesions, infection, the flap cover. And so here in this area, you should go flush up to the bone, straight with the knife. Nothing lies there. But above that, yes, a little above, about a 2 centimeter bone, 2 centimeter below there, below this area is the area of the sural now. We have the peroneal tendons there. So then we do protect them. So, but in the center of the L, yes, we should go straight way up to this thing, and then start elevating the flap thick with the help of a knife or with the help of a thick periosteum elevator till we get this calcaneal fibular ligament. As you can see beautifully here, I put my small periosteum elevator under the calcaneal fibular ligament, which exactly overlies the talocalcaneal joint or the posterior facet. Unless you cut it, you will not be able to see it. Okay, but incised in such a way, you should be able to suture it well with one or two anchor sutures there. Okay. Yeah. So, like I'm dissecting it here, there. So that's a ballooned out, fractured, thin lateral wall, as you can see here. And that's the calcaneal fibular ligament, as you can see it here. Yeah, I've taken a limited incision, not extended too far below. It is almost like a sub-sinus tersi approach, sort of the middle, this thing. sorry. Then that's cutting with a knife, and I left about, if you see it here, I left about 2 to 3 millimeters of the stump for a later closure of the this calcaneal fibular ligament. There. Once you cut that at the posterior facet, the talocalcaneal joint is under vision there. There. And then you have below that you have this ballooned out lateral wall of the calcaneum there. So that was where the calcaneal fibular ligament was there. Okay. And always use KYS into the talus for retraction of the flap. So no arbitrary retraction with thick or very forceful retraction with the right angles. They're absolutely very important. Keep the flap as thick as possible. I said you elevate it from the bone only directly. So you preserve the maximum vascularity from the deep fascia up to the skin. And then now you can use this ballooned out lateral wall to open it like an open book to explore the depressed fragment. Now that is the lateral wall. I'm trying to create a plane out there. Now using the periosteum to create a plane, and so that I can slowly elevate this like an open book. Yeah, so that's how I opened up it. Just cleaning the area now. Underneath is the posterior facet, if you can see that. Yeah, where I'm putting my roller gauze. That's a depressed articular fragment, yeah. This. All these tissues are covering it. And anterior to is the anterior part of the. Facet. So that's the anterior part of the facet. Yeah, so just trying to create a plane. Yeah. Between this anterior part and the depressed part of the. Posterior facet. Slowly it will be. Okay, so now we can see this beautifully, the articular portion of the posterior facet. The calcaneum, which is now completely tilted into the anterior part of the calcaneum. It's in fact, it has become almost like vertical. Okay. So now the next maneuver is you give little varus with your thumb with a thinner eminence. And then create a plane just between the anterior calcaneum and the part of the, and between the posterior facet. So create a plane there. You create a cleavage there. Next step is now to create a cleavage on the plane under this posterior facet so that you can start elevating it. And this plane has to be very carefully created, because otherwise if you just try to push it up there, Well, you may not have a good area left to put your screws, something. It's basically a spongy cancellous bone there. So usually try to create a plane about 1 to 2 centimeter below the articular area and create a horizontal plane there. Next step is to go behind it, behind the posterior facet in the tuberosity areas. That is very important because then otherwise you can pass a bone hook into the tuberosity areas to basically to pull it down. And if this posterior facet is still a part of the tuberosity, as like here, you can see it here, we can use a thick K-wire or a stamen pin to manipulate it also, okay? And so that we can use, elevate the depressed fragment to the Taylor dome. So now all these four steps, that's creating the plane between the posterior facet and the anterior calcaneum, creating a plane under the depressed fragment, dissecting the area behind it so that you can pull it down or use a levering maneuver with a K-wire or something. So all these steps should be done simultaneously, because this elevation of the posterior facet and pulling down the tuberosity should be done simultaneously. That's very important. As you can see it here, that's how I'm trying to elevate it. I'm elevating it to the Taylor dome or the inferior Taylor facet. Okay, so already created a plane underneath the talus, like underneath the depressed fragment. There. Now trying to put a bone hook around it. So that is that open book lateral wall. Huh? Putting it and then trying to pull it. Ask my assistant to pull the tuberosity or pull the tendocalis down there. They pull the tuberosities and at the same time trying to elevate the posterior facet. There. Maintain. So this maneuver, you align it. What this arrow shows is the opposite side of posterior facet, which is attached to the sustentaculum tali or the medial part, which is attached to the forefoot and the midfoot there. So what we do is when we elevated it to the dome of the talus, this there, we automatically align it to the opposite fragment. As you can see it beautifully here, this lateral fragment has been elevated and is aligned. As you can see it here, it is aligned to the medial sustentacular a part of the posterior facet. And then I have passed 2 K-wires in the thalamic area or the subthalamic area, you can call it, about 2 to 3 millimeters below the articular facet. That is probably the thickest area, and passing it along the like an interfrag wires. And if you see this second wire is slightly little cephalid, trying to go into the sustentaculum tali there. So now use these thick areas, as we discussed earlier, the thalamic areas, the Gissen's angle, and the sustentaculum tali for the screw purposes. Okay, and as I said, this direction of the screw should be about 10 to 15 degrees cephalid into the sustentaculum tali. Okay. Yeah. So now we have got the congruent joint, subtalar joint. We have pulled the tuberosity down there. So when these two steps are done, that means during you pull the tuberosity down, you elevate the posterior facet, we reduce the joint, and both these procedures also helps in restoring the height of the calcaneum. And when the height of the calcaneum has been restored, the width has already been restored there. And this almost, okay, so there. So now, but sometimes, so in the previous manual, the tuberosity is almost gets reduced in position in about 80 to 90% of the cases in this manual, always, okay? But sometimes tuberosity is a separate fragment which requires an extra manipulation. And I mean, you already fixed the articular segment and the tuberosity is a separate fragment. There is a third part of the fracture. In that case, then I put another stamen pin or a sand screw. I usually use a 2.7, the metacarpal sand screws, so which can be, which is usually of the length of the calcaneum and remains about a centimeter outside. And it's easy to manage and it's quite stiff enough and stiff enough to manipulate, and it's thin enough to put two, actually. So we put those sand screws, advance it till the fracture and use it like an SX laparoscopy down there. And then once it is reduced, the tuberosity is reduced down to restore the bolus angle. And then you restore the Gissens angle. Once it is restored, Gissens angle, you advance it into the anterior calcaneum. And if the anterior calcaneum is also comminuted, you advance it into the cuboid. And this restoration of the Gissens angle, that means you are restoring the length of the calcaneum. You can additionally put even a screw in interfrag from this Gissens angle into the sustentaculum tele from here also. There, so that will give an additional fixation point there. Okay. So this tuberosity reduction of the Gissens angle will restore height, width, and the length of the calcaneum there. As you can see it here, that was a tuberosity reduction maneuver which I'm doing it there. Put this 2.7 sand screw there, entered it. I wanted to take it slightly more kefal at the handle so that I can give a good maneuver. I introduced it further, yeah, up to the fracture site. Okay, now, yeah, it has reached up to the fracture site. And now, push it at the base, you know, where it is getting inserted into the bone, you know, to get the good leverage. I'm just pushing it down, yeah, to get it, okay? There, and then asking my assistant to advance the pin once reduction is being done. Yeah, you can use a weight gauze in the base there. Yeah, pull it down and then someone can advance it. This pin has to be passed absolutely parallel to the lateral surface of the calcaneum. So the entry point should be about a centimeter medial to the lateral surface for the lateral part of the calcaneal tuberosity and pass it parallel to the lateral surface. So that will go along the axis of the calcaneum. Because as I said, the axis of the calcaneum is about 45 degree divergent to the axis of the foot or axis of the talus there. Reattach and advance it at least till a good hold into the anterior part of the calcaneum or the anterior part of the cuboid. Okay, so after reduction, the Gissens angle, I just said it reduces the length of the Gissens angle. Now, after reductions, putting screws, everything on this. That was the an additional screw put to the Gissens angle there. And as I said, this wire has to be passed parallel to the lateral surface of the calcaneum there. But this technique is basically described by Diego Fernandez and Coelho was described in 93's CRRO. That was a special CRRO being published for calcaneal fractures. And yeah, the whole technique with a minimal fixation, like open reduction, intra-articular reduction, and a minimal fixation. And I follow this Fernandez-Coelho technique. Now, after this, now obviously there is a void left after elevation. Now there are certain believers, and yes, and I think it's like already been proved, even if you leave this void, it fills up once slowly. Yeah, I usually prefer to put a bone graft, in fact, a corticocancellous slivers in a vertical manner supporting the depressed posterior area, the elevated posterior facet, and then place the lateral wall fragments in its place like this. Either you can put and normally take a vital stitch between this. So make two or three small holes with a K-wise, thin K-wise, and then use the vital to stitch up this lateral wall fragment so that they stick to each other in there. Or if they're too comminuted, you can just place it properly and you can apply even a small bone wax, a part of the bone wax also there. So that's how it's being managed, the lateral wall. I strongly feel there is no need of plate because the additional strength is not required because the articular reduction is already held by interflex screws and they are very strong screws there. And the weight bearing anyway is not allowed even if we put the plate for about 6 to 8 weeks there. And in case of any wound breakdown, this subcutaneous plate gets exposed, whereas here with this, the technique which I described, Fernandez-Coelho technique, it usually doesn't give, I mean, like even if there is a wound adhesions, only tracing will solve the problem with no implant exposure. At the most, unless the whole flap gets devascularized and open, then those subarticular screws might get exposed, but what that's a pity that. This wound closure is absolutely important. If you see here, the skin should not be under any stress. If you see those angle areas, the angle areas, I have taken something called the half mattress suture. The half mattress suture is something where you put take a stitch around through the broader part of the this thing from the outer surface, go only through the subcutaneous fat on the flap side and come out. Okay, so there is no tension created onto the skin. Okay, and the skin is closed. So the angle, about 3 stitches, preferably take this half mattress stitch, you know, so that there is no stretch, because even a stretch onto the flap, they can cause narrowing of the vessel and this angle can become, this angle of this flap can become blackish. Okay, so postoperatively, usually strict elevation on 2 to 3 pillows there, usually with ice fomentation, one wound check, and usually once the wound is good after about suture removal, then I start mobilizing the range of motion, then there is no need to give the slab. But or giving slab, elevation, ice fomentation is really important for the next 2 weeks. Remove the pins or the sand screws after about 6 weeks. A few cases I'd done earlier, I'll just show, this was way back in, like I've spoken about these cases in the viral presentation I did in 2003. This was preoperative x-rays. And these were immediate post-op x-rays. There, maintenance of the angle. This was about 8 months follow-up. This was on the normal side. I fixed with 3 screws there. His range of motions, this is a second case, almost like a 3-part fracture. Use those 2 sand screws anchored into the cuboid. Actually, the anterior part of the calcaneum was also comminuted there, and 2 articular screws there. This was his 3-month follow-up. This is almost his 3-year follow-up there. This was a 3rd case again, highly comminuted this thing. Used those 2 articular screws, this interfrag articular screws and 2.7 sand screws. This is 2 years follow-up. This is about a 3.5-year follow-up of his case. I had not done any plating till now. You know, all those 28 cases was done by my senior that time. Those 3 cases and 1 case we did a fixator there. Other 24 cases which I did with this minimal fixation, Fernandez Coiler technique. In fact, only 2 cases had a wound breakdown there. For those 2 cases with the plating, out of 3 cases had a wound breakdown. In fact, that made me think, I think we should give a try to some other procedures and try possibly minimal internal fixation there. And I will go through all these things, the evaluation criteria, but the majority of the patient, the 15 out of 28 had no pain till now, but 10 had occasional pain, 6 had a minimal pain on walking. Subtalar movement was good in about 15 patients, out of 24, and that was more than 75% of the normal side. No instability on uneven grounds, and the resumption of the previous job was by almost in 90%. We could get, you must realize during the presentation, the articular portion, when we give varus, the articular portion is seen so well. We almost, I think, on almost more than 95% of the cases, we can get an absolutely anatomic reduction there. As you can see it here, almost after this 25 cases, we could get less than 1 millimeter step. Means whatever to the visual eye, it is almost like anatomical reductions. Only in 2 patients, we had a 2 to 3 millimeter step, and the angle was restored to almost to satisfactory around 40 degrees in most, that means around 135 degrees, the broader angle there. Usually you can finish off in about 1.5 to 2 hours, this procedure. Almost about 85% patient had good result as far as the pain is concerned. They resume within 6 months, more than 95%. So with 85% good to excellent results and with less than a 10% infection or wound problems, I feel it's a good technique. The take-home message for all the audiences today is, I think we understand the fracture geography is very important. If it is a 2-part split fracture, whether it is intra-articular or extra-articular, still can be managed with the percutaneous technique manual and getting a good reduction there. So whether it's extra articular, intra articular doesn't make much difference to me. Like as I described earlier, we can use this joystick manual to elevate and advance it. If it is a 3-part, 4-part fracture with the depressed middle fragment of the joint, but if that depressed part of the joint is a part of the tuberosity fragment, then that tuberosity fragment can still be treated with this joystick manual there. But if it is that depressed middle part is a separate fragment, yes, then that is an absolutely requires open reduction with a proper L-shaped approach, like as I described, or we can have a simple, a minimal, limited sinus tarsi approach with a horizontal incision with an additional percutaneous, either screw KYS or whatever external fixator. But getting the goals restored is very important. There are a few newer techniques which in this external fixator. There's a new technique which I just came to know and we tried in 2 or 3 patients. I just advise my residents to do this, where we put one pin into the talar neck and one pin in the calcaneum, which is absolutely perpendicular to the long axis of the tuberosity. And the other one is perpendicular to the long axis of the sustentacular talar segment. Okay. Like in, they're usually into absolute varus. And then we distract on the medial side and compress on the lateral side like this and put a fixator and then do a minimal open reduction. This thing, and you can put an intra-articular screw or something. So there are many techniques being described as Dr. Vaibhav, Dr. Sampath, Dr. Mahendra, and Dr. Shivshankar, and I think all of you esteemed surgeons. I say every surgeon has his own method developed after years of experimentation and experience. And so all methods are good if the goals are achieved. I'm not against plating. And there are certain indications, in fact, you know, where probably plating may give a good result in selected cases. My only request to all those who want to attempt is, I think we should respect soft tissues, and soft tissues will respect you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Shivshankar, for giving me this opportunity. All the panelists, Dr. Vaibhav, Dr. Sampath, Dr. Mahendra, thank you very much. And of course, our team, Dr. Ashok Shyam and Dr. Bizlani. Thank you very much again.
Thank you, sir. Thank
you very much, sir.
Over to you.
Yes, that was an excellent presentation. Actually, I didn't interfere you because the way you, the thought process were flowing and you are describing anatomy and all in detail. It was so nice that everything was very lucid and crystal clear, and you have definitely made your point clear that minimal invasive surgery is possible and open it, one should give proper respect to the soft tissue to get a good respect from the soft tissue also. My first question is ice fomentation. You are enumerating so many times ice fomentation. How do you, is it a ice in the plastic bag you keep the ice, or these are some anything special? Because you said that even for initial 7-8 days, you said your ice packs, how many days this ice works, means to reduce the swelling? Does it really work?
Normally,
yeah.
I think most of the sports people will realize usually helps in the initial 1 or 2 days, I think the most. The post-operative ice fomentation is usually, I mean, since we give a plaster slab for the rest and this thing, we put a plastic like the poly drape over the slab and then ask patient to collect in ice into a plastic bag, you know, so it doesn't leak and unnecessarily soak the dressings. And above all, put another plastic drape or a poly drape over the slab and give the ice over it. Put the ice, especially those initial 1-2 days, it's very important for me.
Yes. Over to other faculty for any questions. Yes, Mahendra.
Yeah. Hi.
Hello, yeah.
Yeah, Dr. Rath.
Yes,
excellent.
Yes,
I mean, I think you've given a very elaborate presentation. And I am very happy that you have insisted that, you know, the soft tissue is the key to doing a good reduction. But I think one of the things that a newcomer who wants to start doing calcaneus fractures is that he should sit with the calcaneus and keep looking at it day and day out. It is like the pelvis. You know, till you don't sort of register that bone in your brain in, with all its extensions, you are not going to be able to. And the second thing that happens is that we must not try the sinus tarsi approach till you have done at least 40 or 50 open reductions. Because for you to get a hang of what that facet is, where it lies, you know, it takes some time. Maybe some people have a good learning. I mean, some people are a good surgeon, so they would pick it up in 10 cases. But generally, if you try and do a good open reduction, then you will get the confidence to do a limited open approach. So don't try to do a limited open approach in unselected cases or as your initial cases, because it can be very frustrating. So choosing your cases for limited open reduction is one thing. Understanding the patho-anatomy by doing a CT scan and studying the CT scan in detail so that you know where your screws are going to go, what is the length of the screw. And third is that how you use the image intensifier on the table so that you get the correct views, you get the correct understanding, especially when you're trying to put your sustentacular screw. So many times we know that, you know, these screws are either out and they will start irritating the FHL, FTL tendon, or they will penetrate. So I think a three-dimensional anatomy of calcaneus is extremely important. And very, very important, you can, the Algovera Donati stitch that you give, a half metre stitch, is a very, very key point. So I think congratulations on an excellent presentation. And
thank you very much.
Because you've really started well with anatomy, and then gradually, once you understand the anatomy of the calcaneus, then it becomes easy for you to understand the deforming forces and which deformities you need to correct in a sequential manner.
Thank you. And I think, skeleton is the best guru. I think I always ask my residents and my other assistant professors also, okay, like if, whenever we don't understand whether it's a pelvis or whether it's a spine or it's a calcaneum, just sit with a skeleton and you might get hundreds of ideas how to correct it.
Absolutely.
And I think a CT scan has made a lot of difference. We can sit on the console, or now I think most of the apps can have those 3D reconstruction in our own laptop. And you can really rotate it around a three-dimensional, you can actually understand, you can, you know, like score in your mind, okay, where exactly and what steps you will be doing it. Yeah, true.
Yeah. Absolutely fine. It's a very good presentation, Dr. Rathod.
Thank you, Dr.
Yeah. Do you feel that is there any time need for the bone grafting?
No. I usually do a bone.
Because it's a void. It's a, like an eggshell. So this is, I understood, but this is just for the discussion purpose. I am asking you whether you had done any time bone grafting.
No, I do always. In fact, I try to do take out corticocancellous slivers and put it in a position so that it supports, it's exactly under those elevated posterior fragments. So after 6 weeks, I remove my KYs or whatever sand screws which I used to put in. So it usually gets consolidated quite well there. And plus the lateral wall, which I'm saying, those thin lateral wall, which I use it like an open book.
Yeah.
I place it back. So that also goes and sits over that graft there.
Okay.
Onto the point.
Your focus is mainly on the fixation in the calcar, which is supposed to be the sustentum tali, which is supposed to be the calcar of the calcaneum, which is the strongest portion.
Yes.
So the aim should be engage some fixation tips in the sustentum tali so that it will hold the fragments together. That is the main crux of success.
Yeah. True.
And second thing, you said very aptly that height is inversely proportional to the width in treating. So the aim should be to restore the height and to maintain the width. That is the main crux in having good results. And if you try to primarily fix the fragments, the requirement for the subsequent subtalar fusion, it is very less. And the shape of the foot is also quite better than a bag of bone if we treat it conservatively only. So it's a very nice and elaborative presentation. What is it?
Thank you very much. Yeah.
We try to achieve by the percutaneous way. We puncture the lateral wall, and with a small spike, we try to elevate and push all fragments towards the inferior surface of the talus. You mentioned that use that talus as a template push everything towards the ceiling. So automatically we achieve, we confirm it and percutaneously fix it by screws.
Yeah.
In my many presentations, I operate the calcaneum, but I got some confidence. I put the screw in the reverse way for the sustained tali, which prevents the width of the broadening of the heel. So I put it from the medial side. I clinically palpate and percutaneously put a guide wire from the sustained tali to the lateral wall.
Okay.
So as you mentioned, we have to sit with the calcaneum. We should understand the slopes of the all articular surfaces. That is very important. So the direction of this guide wire has to be very particular. It should, if I am putting it from the sustained tali, it should go inferiorly, little bit posteriorly, and caudally.
Yeah.
So that it should not pierce coming through the sinus tarsi.
Yeah, okay. You are doing the reverse way. So
yeah, I am going in the reverse way. Okay. Fortunately, I have not injured any time a vessel or a tendon and achieve good results.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank
and
you.
That comes with experience, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, that's so. So, he, as Dr. Mahindra said, in understanding the pelvic percutaneous fixation or spine percutaneous, putting the pedicle screws and putting screws in calcaneum, we have to sit with the bone very frequently, understand the anatomy. We have to study this 3D CT very regularly, and we have to spare time planning for where I'm going to put the screws. What should be there? Whether I put the screws all in the axial plane or one in the horizontal plane, coronal plane. So proper planning is very important.
Yeah, I think I always insist is that the goals and the principles are more important. How we achieve, every surgeon has his own method. Like you put it in a reverse way, I put it in a different way. Some of you might be putting a plate, some of you might be putting a fixator, anything. The ultimate, the goal should be achieved. And I think regarding the minimal or a proper exposure, I think as we get a bit more mature with understanding of the fracture geography, slowly the area becomes slowly and slowly. You know that
you also mentioned very rightly that where we should not put the screw heads, that is the weight bearing portion or the heel pad, where we should not put or injure that heel pad. So it is
very
this is very important, because last week I have seen one X-ray. He has achieved a good result, say he good reduction. But his screw heads were in the area where they should not be.
True, true.
So that is a very important thing, that this area should be avoided.
It's a day-to-day life of our life. You know, it's mean, every time we put weight on
correct
this thing, and if it's going to hurt us, that's not the right thing. We should do it.
That's
we don't have right to do it. Yeah.
Dr. Rathod, one more point I want to make.
Sure.
It is also very important to understand that compound calcaneus fractures have to be, they're at a completely different level. And if you want to make some points on that.
Sorry, couldn't hear.
Yeah. What I'm saying is that compound calcaneal fractures are something that is a different level completely. And it is very important that we treat these fractures in a very different way, because, you know, especially all these guys, especially fall in the septic tank or fall. So history is extremely important, where they have landed, what was the ground, what was the soil, and treating, because if this patient gets infected, then this can be a really horrible outcome. And so if you can mention something about how you plan your compound calcaneal fractures which present to you.
I think I didn't have the opportunity. I think probably except one or two cases about the compound calcaneum, but those last two, three slides which I mentioned about the external fixator and the neo techniques of the external fixator, I think probably can go a long way in, you know, in stabilizing the calcaneum in a reasonably acceptable anatomical position there. I think that should do the
trick. I think it's time now. It's already 8:30 and
Sampath.
Yes, yes. Sampath is very quiet as usual.
Yeah, every point is mentioned. So I agree. In calcaneum, you have given all the messages very clearly. it's not about only intra-articular part, it's about the heel varus, height and width. Even if you correct this much, so many times patient is helped a lot. So just do adequate, do choose your patient correctly, and along with intra-articular components, even these components are very important. The heel varus, height and width, even you, you should take care of these components. So very well said.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Sampath. I think all the procedures, like in orthopedics anywhere, I mean, like everywhere, whatever all the procedure described, there is always an indication for that particular procedure, a specific indication. We have a tendency to extend our indications. Okay, we learn one procedure, so we try to do it for all the types. So that's our tendency, but there is an indication for everything, for all the surgeries. Yes, and that comes with experience. Thank you, Dr. Sampath. Yep.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Ashok Kumar Rathod, sir.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
You have clearly mentioned that the height of calcaneum is inversely proportional to the breadth. So we have to maintain the height as well as breadth. And you also clearly mentioned that the amount of time you spend with bone model, X-rays and 3D is inversely proportional to the time you take it for doing surgery, actually. So the more your time you spend in preoperative planning, less time you spend during the surgery.
And less complications.
Yes, correct. Thank you. Thank you very much. It was a wonderful talk. And
thank you.
Everybody will be benefited, not necessarily the postgraduate students, even senior orthopedic surgeons, also those who treat calcaneal fractures, trauma surgeons like me. Everybody will be benefited by your talk. Thank you very much. I must
thank you very much. Thank you.
Vaibo Gandhi, Dr. Sampath Dumre Patil, as well as Dr. Mahendra Kutcharkar for being with me here today for the discussion part. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you
very much. Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Yeah, have a good day and stay safe. Thank you.